like from the
pictures,
it looked like it was all in the,
the
roof, you know.
Yeah,
but
up,
it started in the furnace, the air conditioner, and he tried to put it out.
Yeah.
And then it was in the walls, which he didn't know.
Oh.
And then he phoned 911.
Oh, shoot.
So Mary Hill was there, Guelph was there, all
It's nice to have inside information.
Yeah.
Well, because the issue, remember last time, it took years before they rebuilt.
Yeah.
I think the insurance.
It was 2005, apparently.
I think because the footprint so close to the lake, you know, they kind of fight the fact that you can't rebuild there. So I hope they can, because that's
they
the.
They said maybe condos, you never
know.
That would be such a shame to do that.
Where are these people coming from? Every corner there's a condo.
Yeah, they would, because that would
be talks.
And then they would just lease
the
property.
Property to the restaurant.
Oh wait, there we go. Can you hear me? Yeah. 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 So,
I know my times pretty well, I guess.
Hi, John.
There we go.
Hi.
Come on in. Your shipmate is here.
I'll move over there.
Were there any guys, gentlemen there last week? I said, yeah, they were ringing around the outside.
That last hour was interesting.
If they don't leave a message, it couldn't have been too important. That's how I feel.
You did.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I welcome you to St. Luke's United Church in Cambridge. And we're in our smaller space in the Mary Clemens room, just because it's a little cooler in here. The warmth of the outside reminds us of the warmth of God's love, and sometimes it's a lot of warmth. So, just a couple of announcements. First of all, we welcome Linda this morning. Linda Paul has led us in worship many, many times, and so we're very happy to have her again this morning. Welcome, Linda. Just a couple of announcements. The food bank is always in need of donations, and the need in the community, of course, is always great. So we thank you for being able to bring in food donations. I'm going to move on to our next. At our Truckin' Tuesdays, we also have our grocery cart available for you to bring food items, non-perishable food items, and also we're accepting monetary donations for the food bank. So on Tuesdays, if you're looking to get out of a hot kitchen, come on over to St. Luke's, and we have two or three trucks that come each week. I believe this week's schedule is Ish and Chips, and Just for Fun, and Schmuck Truck. So as a variety of things, we're always happy to see you come between 4:30 and 8 p.m. So you can bring your friends and family, bring a blanket if you'd like to have a bit of a picnic. We also have tables available where you can be seated and enjoy your food. Or you can take it back home if you like. So thank you for your support, and it's always a lot of fun. Before we move on to the rest of our service, I would also like to announce that we're very happy that Jerry Sebastian has taken on the role of temporary custodian for our church, as our custodian, George, will be heading for surgery this week. So we keep George in our prayers and wish him well for his surgery and his recovery time. And thank you to Jerry for stepping in and filling the gap while George is away. I'll turn the service over to Linda.
Could you announce the council meeting on August 10th?
Ah, sorry.
Yes, it's unique.
We don't normally have council meetings during the summertime, but we have a few important things to discuss. So we will be having a council meeting on August the 10th. Is that a Tuesday?
Wednesday,
August the 10th at 7:30 p.m. And it will be on Zoom. So for the council members, look for an email from Rosemary, our secretary, for the link to the Zoom. And we would really look forward to your presence. As I say, there are a number of things that we need to discuss. Thank you. Linda.
Thank you, Daria. And hello and good morning, everyone. On the last day of July. Well, it's hard to believe. August is always a little depressing because you know where that slide is going. Thank you to Daria and to Andrew. Daria for her music leadership, Andrew for his technical. And many of you don't know, Daria helps and Andrew help with the PowerPoint and presenting the slides and so on, as well as Helene in the office. So thank you to those as well for putting this all together. We'll begin with our land acknowledgement. As we gather, we are reminded that we are situated on land that is steeped in rich Indigenous history and home to many First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people today. As a congregation, we have a responsibility for the stewardship of the land on which we live, worship, and work. Today, we acknowledge the traditional territories of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and the Attawandaroc people. We gather on the Haldimand Tract, the land promised to the Six Nations that includes 6 miles on each side of the Grand River. May we live with respect on the land and in friendship, truth, and reconciliation with its people. Is somebody called to come up and light the Christ candle? Thank you, Rosemary. We light this candle to remind us that Christ is the light of the world, and he is present today and always. Thank you. When Jesus greeted people, especially after the resurrection, he greeted them with the words, "Peace be with you." Let us now greet each other with words of peace and waves.
Peace be with you all. And to everybody out there in cyberspace and time travelers, God bless. Peace be with you all, and we'll see you again next week. Join us in the air conditioning. It's rather nice.
Thank you, Andrew. Let us take a moment. Take a deep breath. Settle in. Let us now take a moment to be still and know our God. Let us take time to reflect in this time of worship. And our call to worship is from the Mennonite Church Canada website, and we'll do it, say it responsibly. God stretches out the heavens and shapes the earth.
Come and give thanks.
God raises up the mountains and pours water into the seas.
Come and give thanks.
God calls forth plants from the soil and forms animals in infinite variety.
Come and give thanks.
God breathes upon us and fills us with life.
Come with your voices in praise.
God gives our lives meaning through laughter and tears.
Come with your voices in praise.
God touches our hearts through family and friends.
Come with your voices in praise.
God loves us and blesses us with everything good.
Come and worship.
God loves us and overwhelms us with never-ending generosity.
Come and worship.
God loves us and surrounds us with love in abundance.
Come and worship.
Our opening hymn is O For a World, Voices United 697, and up on the screen.
Oh, for a world where everyone
Let us pray. Gracious God, we confess that at times we take what you have given us for granted. We can forget that what we have in abundance is meant to be shared and not kept for safekeeping. We come today to worship you and learn, to learn that you want us to share our wealth, the wealth of our time, the wealth of our talents, the wealth of our knowledge, the wealth of our food, clothing, goods, and money. In this place of worship, we come to listen, to think, and to learn more about your message of distribution and thereby relationship with our neighbor. It is your message of love. Amen.
On August the 1st, in 1835, the British government officially abolished slavery. And so the choir is going to share a song this morning, thinking about that, keeping that in mind. We're going to sing a South African song called We Are Marching.
Chapter 12, verses 13 to 21, the parable of the rich fool. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, I will do this. I will put down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? It is with those who store up treasures for themselves. So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich towards God. Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we are gathered here today to worship you, still our minds and our bodies, that we may hear your word. So we're going to start the meditation with a short video done by Denzel Washington. And thank you to Andrew, who performed miracles to get this up for you.
One of the most important lessons in life that you should is to remember to have an attitude.
You have to go back.
Gratitude. Humility. Understand where the gift comes from.
Sorry, forgot to think about the volume on the television.
Likewise, last night for me too, sorry.
My apologies.
No. One of the most important lessons in life that you should know is to remember to have an attitude, gratitude, humility, understand where the gift comes from. It's not mine, it's been given to me by the grace of God. Use what I have. Use what you have. To help others. You know, even on your last day, you can't take it with you.
That's true.
But you can be there. You'll never see a U-Haul behind a hearse.
Thank you.
One of the most important lessons in life that you should know.
It's okay, we're all patient. It's a very powerful message.
There you go. Yeah.
So the title of my meditation is, you will never see a U-Haul behind a hearse. I love that statement by Denzel Washington. I've heard it in some country songs, have done it too. It says it all, doesn't it? It's a way of conveying the message of the parables of the rich fool. In verse 15 of today's scripture, Jesus says, take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. In our modern Western culture, we aim to succeed. We are bombarded by the media and retail to make money, spend, build up possessions, get the newest this or that. We work hard to save for a rainy day or retirement, and that is okay. We should not feel guilty because we have worked hard and done well enough for ourselves so that we can have all that we need. But when is enough enough? When is the acquisition of wealth and possessions too much? When does this acquisition become a disease of hoarding and vanity? Have you ever watched the TV show program Hoarders? So you kind of get the gist. The people on the program are real and have accumulated so much stuff to fill an empty space in their hearts that their homes become cesspools of filth. They can't use their kitchens, sleep in their own beds. They let the maintenance of their dwellings slide so much that it is on the verge of being condemned. They risk losing children, grandchildren, or spouses, or their homes because of the overwhelming amount of stuff that has now become garbage. A psychologist works with them along with a cleanup team to sort and organize all their stuff. These compulsive hoarders cannot let go and dispose of or donate anything without having a violent or emotional breakdown. It does usually end on the program better that they've learned. It's tragic to watch how they have distanced themselves from help, family, and God. The common denominator is that their lives have become vain and empty. The rich man in the parable is considered to be a fool because he appears to live only for himself, and because he believes that he can secure his life with his abundant possessions. When the rich man talks in the parable, he talks only to himself, and the only person he refers to is himself. In verses 17 to 19, he says, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grains and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, and be merry." Fast forward for a moment to today, and think about the abundance of self-storage facilities that are everywhere. I see these facilities being built all the time, all over the place, and now multi-level. There are 17 of these multi-unit facilities in the KW area. The rich man's foolishness lies in the fact that he shows no gratitude to God for the land that produces so abundantly. He shows no gratitude to the workers, those that planted, tended, and harvested the crops. He has enough stored away to last 10 lifetimes, but he wants it all for himself. And on top of that, he has no one to share it with, family or friends. At the beginning of the parable is the man who speaks to Jesus to prompt this parable. He is wanting Jesus to arbitrate the distribution of an inheritance. He wants Jesus to validate his desire for wealth. So Jesus teaches him a lesson through story. Greed for money and wealth is the idol worshipped by so many. Greed shuts out anyone that may harm or threaten what is ours. Wars are created because of greed for land, money, resources, and power. Families can be torn apart because one or more person is overworking or overspending or hoarding, and the family is denied of a healthy, secure, and loving relationship. Even some religious organizations try to justify their greed in order to manipulate, blackmail, or guilt some people into worshiping the idol they have created. Professor Matt Skinner wrote it this way: "The way the parable is explicitly framed makes it warn against greed, acquisitiveness, and egoistic preoccupation with one's own security. It offers an explanation for why otherwise ordinary, hardworking people might end up existing in their own self-absorbed universes, constructing lives in which they don't have to give a damn about anybody else, especially the people they can't see or don't want to see." It's a troubling situation we are seeing these days. The divisiveness, the partisanship, the injustices being done by individuals, organizations, and governments. The rate of homelessness, drug use, the need for food banks. Governments and organizations aren't all bad, but I ask you to consider the rich man in the parable. How is your society or community like him? Then consider this. What would Jesus' teachings mean when the populations of only 10 nations possess 79% of the world's total wealth, even though they constitute only 29% of the world's total population? 71% of the population is then in poverty, of the world's population. This attitude of vanity creates an emptiness that cannot be filled by riches. The painting up on the screen is called Rich Fool by artist James B. Janknet. In his artistic impression of the parable, the rich man dines and dies alone in a large house, which is furnished with a literally heartless piece of sculpture. And you can see that it looks like a little child, but it's a sculpture and it's missing its heart. While a family of eight enjoys one another's company around a table in a more modest dwelling nearby. I'll give you a moment to study the painting. So while this parable is easy enough to interpret, the message is pretty strong. And I do not want to make any of you squirm or feel guilty in any way. That's not the purpose of today's message. God wants us to live abundantly, to eat, drink, and be merry, to enjoy life to its fullest as best as we are able. Jesus did so often. He spent time with friends and family, laughed, drank, dined, danced, traveled, and enjoyed himself. But Jesus knew where his true priorities lay. His priority was God, and our priority is God. We are only stewards of the gifts he has given us, including our very living and breathing lives. Do we align ourselves with acquisitions and desires, or do we align with God and our neighbor? God's desires and the life of Jesus and the presence of the Holy Spirit are our compasses. We are only stewards or caretakers of our lives, our possessions, and all creation. Our purpose is to take care of ourselves in body, mind, and spirit, to show gratitude for all that we have been given, to share our time, to care for and protect our planet and neighbors, and share the God-given riches so that we can help redeem the world. This alliance with and for God is our only security. We do not know when our earthly lives will end. That is a random inevitability that will affect everyone. Whether one is wealthy or poor, the end will come. And as the saying goes, you can't take it with you. The rich fool is in the parable was to die that night, rich in earthly treasure, but not rich towards God. An experienced pastor once said, I have heard many different regrets expressed by people nearing the end of life, but there is one regret I have never heard expressed. I have never heard anyone say, I wish I hadn't given so much away. I wish I had kept more for myself. Death has a way of clarifying what really matters. So I'll read the transcript from the movie once again. One of the most important lessons in life that you should learn is to remember to have an attitude of gratitude, of humility. Understand where the gift comes from. It's not mine. It's been given to me by the grace of God. Use what I have, use what you have to help others. On your last day, you can't take it with you, but you can leave it there. You'll never see a U-Haul behind a hearse. So this week, take care of yourself and know that God is rich and generous towards you. And ponder on these words from Colossians chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn now is Take My Life and Let It Be. Voices United 506 and up on the screen. Thank you, Derry. We are grateful for your gifts of time, talents, and money. They provide the means to continue this ministry. Let us pray. Generous giving God, as you have given so much to us and wish us to share our abundance, please accept these gifts we humbly offer to serve your purpose to this congregation, its neighbors, and the world. Amen. Let us now pray for our community. Let us pray. Almighty God, we have come to you today for this world in which we live is your world, brought into being through your love for all your people. As we bring all our concerns before you, we know that you are waiting to hear us and to respond to us. Lord, we pray that you will teach us how to provide for our own lives, mindful of our own needs, yet also of the call of Christ to put our trust in him. Help us to spend our time and our money in a manner worthy of your kingdom of love. Lord, make this church a place of generosity where people work together, giving of who they are and all that they are able, and the wonderful resources of our world may be better shared. We pray today for people who wander through life constantly seeking a purpose, a reason for living. We remember especially those who store up wealth for themselves, believing that the road to happiness is through the accumulation of possessions. Help them to find in you love, acceptance, and wholeness. We pray today for the people suffering war, violence, and oppression, injustice, and prejudice. We pray for those who are ill in body, mind, and spirit. We pray for those who suffer food and shelter insecurities. We pray for those who struggle to make ends meet. We pray for those who mourn. Lord, help us to help them. At this time, we take a moment to offer our silent prayers of concern to you. We make our prayers as part of our common life of worship and service to Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now let us now join together in singing the Lord's Prayer in Voices United 959 and up on the screen. And our closing hymn for today is Today We Are All Called to Be Disciples, Voices United 507, and up on the screen.
today's? Today's blessing. Let me shut it right off. Am I? Can you hear me?
No? Oh, there we go. It just took a moment. It's Samuel, I think, again. Your ghost. Today's blessing will be read responsively. And it was written by Bruce Pruer. Happy are they who know where the real treasure is to be found.
Happy are they who take from the treasure and share it.
Friends of God, prepare to leave this church with spirits higher than when you came in.
Trust in Christ to take an intimate interest in the costly investment he has made.
Invest in others as his love has invested in you.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the Spirit.
The blessing of the eternal God is upon you, redeeming grace, enfolding love, enduring fellowship, now and forever. Go now in peace.
Amen.
Koski family for providing flowers for our service this morning. As you may know, Mary Witkowski is our treasurer, and her sister Linda passed away, and they had a service this week, and so they left flowers for us to have.